But the untrained soldiers and their bewildered leaders failed to push on. Hundreds brewed tea and bathed on the beaches while the vital hours slipped away. On their right, the Anzacs were waging their bitterest battle, Lone Pine. Fighting went on for 2 days. At the end of it, the Turks still held the commanding heights of Surrey Bear. And this meant that the British New Army divisions could not advance either, even when they found out what to do and where to go. Muddle and mischance had prevailed again. The expedition was still blocked. This was the end of hope. Ian Hamilton wrote,
"An ugly dream came to me last night. I was being drowned, held violently under the Hellespont. For hours afterwards, I was haunted by the thought that the Dardanelles were fatal, that something sinister was afoot, that we, all of us, were pre-doomed."
Yet for weary months, the army stayed. It was trench warfare now. Barbed wire, snipers, machine guns, boredom. Like France, yet not like France. Gallipoli was much further away. No one who went there ever came home on leave. From Dover to Calais, 22 miles. From Dover to Cape Helles, 3,000 miles. On Gallipoli, in 37 weeks, 31,000 Allied soldiers were killed, 73,000 were wounded, 93,000 went sick. For the wounded and sick, there were the fly-blown casualty clearing stations. Then the hospital ships, perhaps just to Egypt, with luck, if you survived the journey, all the way back to England. In September, in one Anzac battalion, 78% were suffering from dysentery, 5% from weak hearts. Men developed a sharp appetite for the smaller things. Bathing in the sea became an inexpressible joy. To get away from the flies, wash off the dirt and dust, to feel cool again. One said, in some ways, it was a curiously happy time. In October, Ian Hamilton was recalled. His successor, General Munro, arriving from the Western Front, toured the beaches and came to a swift decision. The peninsula must be evacuated. Winston Churchill said,
"He came, he saw, he capitulated."
But there was no escaping facts. Kitchener went out to Gallipoli to see for himself. His conclusion was,
"Well, I've seen the place. It's an awful place, and you'll never get through."
So the bitter decision was reached, evacuation. But Gallipoli had one last extraordinary trick to play on the defeated Allies. After all the miseries of heat and flies and diarrhea, a blizzard in November put 15,000 men out of action with frostbite. It was the worst storm for 40 years. now they came to the last act on Gallipoli. 120,000 men, thousands of animals, hundreds of guns. What would become of them all? The evacuation plan was a masterpiece. Ironic success in the midst of utter failure. Every possible ruse was employed to persuade the Turks that things were normal. Troops bathed and played games. Reliefs and ration parties went on with empty boxes. Automatic devices fired rifles sporadically along the emptying trenches. Then, with sacking round their boots to dull the sound, the soldiers came away. The Australian General Monash described their departure from Suvla.
Down dozens of little gullies leading back from the front lines came groups of six to a dozen men, the last closing the gully with a frame of barbed wire. All these little columns of men kept joining up like so many rivulets which flow into the main stream. And so at last they coalesced into four continuous lines. There was no check, no halting, no haste or running. Just a steady, silent tramp in single file, without any lights or smoking. And every yard brought us nearer safety.
83,000 men were taken off from Suvla and Anzac in December without a casualty. In January, the whole performance was repeated at Cape Helles.
The tears were streaming down my cheeks. I just couldn't restrain them. My eyes were smarting. I think I walked for the rest of the way with my eyes closed. I knew it so well, and I couldn't go short. I was in a trench. As we got further from the line, near a backhouse post, I remembered the events we had on May the 6th, when more of my pals, Pitovers of Warren, young Yates. I could even hear young Orton crying for his mother as he died. I remember Colonel Quilter, great big chap, ex, straight as a poker, guards officer. I remember him leading the advance and going to his death armed with a huge walking stick. He told us before we landed, when we were on the boat, that the eyes of the world would be upon us, where the eyes of the Turks certainly were. And so were the rifles. But the rest of the world seemed to have forgot us.
And another said, as he set off towards the boats, "I hope they won't hear us going down to the beaches." On the beaches, the last stores blazed, the ammunition exploded. The great adventure was over. The war went on, mounting to new ferocity. No rest for the gaunt survivors. Rest only for the unforgotten dead.